Welcome to the Madness.
Hey, how's it going, folks? The name's Deffy, and welcome to my solo playthrough of the Dungeons & Dragons 5th Edition homebrew module, Curse of the Blood Moon by Adventure Await Studios. Alright, so we're coming to the second episode now. So, in the last episode, our party of adventurers, Free Green Bard, a Eladrian Elf Aberrant Mind Sorcerer, a Ur-Genasi Shadow Magic Sorcerer, and a Beast High Shifting Arcfey Warlock. Yeah, had to make it cut there, I had to think for a second then. Right, so, the whole premise of this story is, the adventurers arrived at the village of Pinewell to stop what seemed to be an evil ritual to bring back a curse, to bring back a blood moon curse on the villagers to turn everybody into some bloodlust evil beings. And that's why we're here. So if you want the full story and the full concept, so to know, the playlist will be in the top right hand corner at the beginning of this episode, so you can go watch them to catch us up if you wish. But for now, we're just going to carry on with the next encounter, which is dubbed the Bloody River. So here we go though. Once the characters have dealt with the commoners, they're free to continue along the road towards Pinewell. It takes 3 hours to get there on foot, and upon arriving at the outskirts of the village, they find themselves witness to a horrific sight. So, as you approach the outskirts of the village, your senses are assailed by the smell of death and smoke. Ahead, a bridge spans a blood-red river, and corpses can be seen lying in the pools of blood upon it, while lifeless bodies flow beneath it. Fires burn bright on the far side, and plumes of thick, acrid smoke rise up into the sky. So, what's happened here is, the characters make a DC 14 wisdom perception check. Success means they notice 3 shapes moving on the far side of the bridge. Failure means that they don't notice the movement until they're halfway across the bridge. And then the encounter is 3 gnolls. So 3 gnolls have been drawn out by the mayhem and have been lighting things on fire in the name of their foul god. They occupied with the arson, so they have disadvantage on wisdom checks to notice the creatures approaching. The gnolls are vicious creatures under normal circumstances, but under the light of the blood moon, they're absolutely savage. They attack with their bite in lieu of their spears and fight until killed. In their rage, they fail to use their shields properly, resulting in a -2 penalty to their armor class. Right, so yes, the party's up against 3 gnolls, so I'm going to get the encounter set up as per the description of the stuff what they want us to do, and I'll see you guys in a sec. Right, okay, so we have the encounter set up. So yeah, so this is what the battle map looks like. So we have ourselves a bloodied river, we have our bodies, and then on the left-hand side, we have our heroes. Now, as per the module says, if we go to the PDF for a second. Yep, right here. It says the characters have to make a DC 14 perception check. Success means they notice 3 shapes moving on the far side of the bridge. Failure means that they don't notice the movement until they're halfway across the bridge. So that is what we're going to do now. We are going to do our... hold on 1 second, I just need to get the dice roller up. Let's do it. There we go. Okay, so we're going to do our perception check, but now we need to see who is actually proficient in perception, is what I'm going to say. Okay, so Alkanak has a +2 to perception. Panmon has a +3 to perception. Scar, this is Scar, right? Just want to double check. Yep. Kind of got the character sheets a bit mixed up. So is a +2 perception. And Talita is a +2 in perception. So in this case, I'm going to say that Panmon being the highest is going to make the check. Now, it depends, because we've got passive perception, which could work. 12, 13, 12, and 12. Nope. So it's going to have to make a manual perception check. Also as well, I've updated the current HP, updated the current experience as well, because we started at level 2, so we started with 300. Got 20 experience from the 8 commoners. So, you know, 80 divided by 4 is 20. So each has 320 experience. Alkanak has 14 health, 17. Palmon has 8. Also, I've fingered out his uses, phase step, so that's just a reminder for myself. And of course, I have put the slots expanded for everybody as well, so keep track. So these character sheets are up to date now. Okay, so we need to make a perception check. So with Panmon, so I'm going to say that the group just takes a slow walk forward to over here. Let me fix. There we go. And then we're going to roll that perception check. So we need to do a d20 plus 3, right? Yep, d20 plus 3. So let's have a look. d20 plus 3. So it needs to be a 14. 10 fails. Okay, so the group comes forward. And they start. And they start walking to about halfway across the bridge. Like so. Get them back on their respective tiles. Okay, so upon approaching the bridge, they see the three gnolls. So the gnolls, just to go over the stat block. So they're a medium humanoid, chaotic evil. They have an armor class of 15 with a hide armor and shield. However, the module specifically says, if we go to the module itself, it specifically says that they failed to use their shields properly, resulting in a minus 2 armor class. So meaning that they have a 13 armor class instead. So they have a 13 armor class instead. 14 strength, 12 dexterity, 11 constitution, 6 intelligence, 10 wisdom, 7 charisma, dark vision of 60 feet, passive perception of 10, physicality bonus plus 2. They have the rampage ability, where the gnoll reduces a creature to 0 hit points with a melee attack on its turn. The gnoll can take a bonus action to move up to half its speed and make a bite attack. And it says that it's going to use its bite attack instead of using its shields or longbow, so it's gone barrel basically, so it's gone back to basics. No. It also says, the module also says as well, get the credits thing up, give me one second, that they're occupied with arson, so therefore, they have a disadvantage on wisdom perception checks to notice the creatures approaching. So we're going to do this, we're going to do a bit of an oracle roll here, if I can get my thing up, thank you. So we're going to do a little bit of an oracle roll. We need to decide if the characters are going to attack straight away, or are they going to go in stealth first? Is this going to be a frontal assault or a surprise attack? So let's do this. So we'll ask a question. Hold on, I just want to make sure my dice rolls work properly. It is, perfect. So we need to ask, is the party going to conduct a surprise attack? 1 to 9 is no, 11 to 20 is yes. 17, they are, right. So in this case, we want stealth rolls now. So yeah, so we want stealth rolls. So we'll start with Arcanine first. Now, Arcanine has a chameleon carapace. Now, let me have a quick look at that. So with Arcanine's chameleon carapace, it says when you wait, if you aren't wearing armor, your carapace gives you a base armor class 13 plus dex modifier. However, it says as an action, you can change the color of your carapace to match the color and texture of your surroundings, giving you advantage on dexterity save checks me to hide in these surroundings. So basically I'm going to say he's going to do that. So he's going to use an action to change the color of his carapace, and then he's going to roll with advantage. So that's what we're going to do then. And of course, like the last episode, if there's any abilities that I'm odd about, I'll just show you on screen what it is as I'm reading. So yeah, also as well, I don't know if you noticed, but I've changed the OBS lower the layer as well, so instead of having like the big red bar across and then having like the name, the image, and the armor class and stuff, I'm gonna see if it can fit a fin in that top right hand corner just to make it a little bit more cleaner in my opinion. So, and then maybe I can have like the abilities across the top of the screen, maybe. We'll see what future Defy does in the future. Anyway, he's talking, so he needs to roll with advantage, so it's a d20 plus 3 and it's the higher of the two. Okay, so let's do that first then. So d20 plus 3. So first one's a 9. 21. Okay, so he gets a 21 stealth roll. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to roll, I'm going to write just quickly. Okay, so I'm just gonna write it here. So I'm just gonna write A 21. Okay, so let's do Panmon next. So he's a D20 plus 2. D20 plus 2, 14. Okay, so now we want Scar now. Scar, I believe, is a D20 minus 2. That's because of his low dexterity score, so this should be interesting. This should be interesting. So this is a D20 minus 2. 8. He actually got a crit! He got a crit. Nice. Natural crit. That's odd, that. I'm gonna take a screenshot of that. Okay, so Scar got a natural 8. I'm going to race his 18. There's a crit, so I'm just going to put a little C at the top just to show. And then Tadita has a plus 1 to stealth, so let's have a look. So D20 plus 1, so she gets a 17. Very nice. So we get stealth scores all over, actually. And then T gets 14. Now we need to do a perception check for the gnolls, because they have disadvantage. So let's have a look. So it's just a D20 disadvantaged. Okay, it's a standard D20. Okay, so it's a 9. So the cool thing is the 9 does not beat the stealth scores here. So the four of them start to notice the gnolls, and Arcanac, being the pseudo leader of the group, looks towards the other people and uses his communication ability, because with free greens they have free green telepathy. Talks to the other guys as in, shh, they don't notice us, let's lower ourselves and let's do a little bit of a surprise attack. So obviously all four of them are stealthed. The three of these are still busy gnawing, chomping, setting things on fire. So with that, I'm going to say that I'm going to take 15 feet forward, and they're going to conduct their attack. So they do a surprise attack, meaning that each of them takes a free action against somebody else before we start to roll initiative for combat. So let's do that first. So again, we're going to follow the same rules as the player rules engagement that we did in the last episode. So just to remind you, actions will be randomized on all PC turns. D6 will be rolled first to determine action type. 1 to 2 is offensive. Any action that requires an attack roll. 3 to 4 is tactical. Any action that involves either debuffs, some kind of control or save or roll or something. 5 or 6 is any action that involves a buff for healing. And then if any action is classed as a bonus action, main action will be an attack type action involving a roll. All movements will be used unless engaged. That's a bit iffy for me. I started doing the randomized rolls of where they're moving and how far they're moving to. Disengage is player specific. And then all actions will be randomized through allocated dice rolls, as well as enemy, party member targeting. Boss will be party randomized. Healer will be on the lowest HP. Spells and weapons has been selected will be equipped on equipped free. So pretty simple. So we're going to start off with... I think we'll start off with the person who has the highest stealth score. In this case, it'll be Arcanac. Yep, okay, so it'll be Arcanac for this thing. So let's see what he's gonna do. So before we do movement as such, we need to determine exactly what he's gonna do. So we're gonna roll a d6 to determine what he's gonna do. Okay, 2, so it's offensive. Okay, so in terms of his offense, his options are either a longsword, a dagger. Yes, the longsword or dagger, so he's going into melee. Because he's used up all his spell slots, so nothing there, and he's not using any cantrips. That's it. So we need to decide if it's going to be a dagger or a longsword attack, so let's have a look. So we'll do a d2 to decide. 1, so he's going in for a longsword attack. So his movement is pretty simple then. Now, the question is, what target is he going for? So we're going to go 1, 2, and 3. Oh God, he's coming back. So we'll go d3. He's targeting the top one. Okay, perfect. Let me give a second. Okay, so with that, Alcanite gives the order to attack. So he's going to go 5, 10, 15. Straight to the wolf. The wolf's like, oh. And Elkanat's going to attack. Now, because it's surprised, they attack with advantage. So we're going to do a d2. So we're going to do a d2 plus... Yeah, d20 plus 3 for the attack bonus. And then he's going to attack with two hands. So it's going to be a 1d10 plus 1 damage. So that's what we're going to do then. So let's go for 1d20 plus 3. Now remember, the AC is 13. Misses. So Alcanat fails. So Panmont is next. So he has his turn there. So Panmont's next. So it's a 14. Is it next? No, next person is Scar. Sorry, excuse me. Next person is Scar. So we need to determine what he's going to do. So we're going to do another d6. Six. Okay, so his options for buffing is either... It's probably one of his spells, actually. It is. So even go, so you can even go friends. So friends? No, that's utility, that. That's outside of combat. Self-values, utility, unseen servant, you could choose. Verifiers, tactical. Okay, so yeah, so it's either unseen servant, speak of animals, or disguise self. So, yeah, okay then. So we'll go one. Actually, hold on. Is unseen servant a casting time to do it? Unseen servant takes... No, you can just cast it straight away. Okay. Nope, you can cast it straight away. So let's do a D2 to determine what he's doing. He could disguise himself again. So look, one. Okay, so he's gonna cast unseen servant then. So let me just do something quickly. So let's go to two to show that he's used up his warlock spell slots. So unseen servant says, the spell creates a visible, mindless, shapeless, medium force that performs simple tasks at your command until the spell ends. The servant springs into existence in an unoccupied spot on the ground within range. It has 10 AC, 1 hit point, a strength of 2, and it can't attack. If it drops to 0 points, the spell ends. On each of your turns as a bonus action, you can mentally command the servant to move up to 15 feet and interact with an object. The servant can perform simple tasks a human servant could do, such as fetching things, cleaning, mending, folding clothes, lighting fires, serving food, and pouring wine. Once you give the command, the servant performs the task to the best of his ability until it completes the task, and it waits for your next command. If you command the servant to perform a task that is moved more than 60 feet away, the spell ends. No. Obviously, the unseen servant can't attack. No, I don't actually have... hold on, give me one little second here. Right, okay, so I just found a random image off of Google. Okay, so the unseen servant cannot make any attacks, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to treat it like it's I'm going to treat it like basically the Find Familiar spell. So basically, even though he can't attack, I'm going to let him do some other abilities, such as stuff like the help action, which allows him to temporarily distract an enemy, allowing for the next attack roll to be made at advantage. Let him use items, but yeah, primarily I'm just going to use him as like a support character, basically. That's it, really. Okay, so I think for a bonus action, I guess it's just going to say just to move probably just behind him, actually, and just let him stay at the back and support if need be. So we're going to do that. Now that we've done that, we need to determine if Scar's going to do any movement. So for this, we need to do... Actually, hold on. Yeah, do you know what's probably best if we do some d20 rolls? Does Scar stay in place? No, okay, so he moves. Okay then, right, so what we're going to do is we're choosing directions. So we can go 1, 2... Okay, so basically it's just 1, 2... 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. 1, okay, so he's going to move back. So I guess he wants to stay behind. So he can move up to 6 feet. 6 squares. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. So let's do a... Let's do a d30 to determine. Oh no, it's a d6, isn't it? Yeah, d6. How many squares? 1. Okay, so he's just going to move 1 square back. He's going to move 1 square back. Okay, and then after Scar, the next person is... Okay, so it's going to be Panmon next, tied with Talita. Yeah, so okay, so we'll see what Panmon's going to do. So he's going to do a D6. Support. Okay. So for his options for support, let's have a look. So we have Fonts of Magic, Telepathic Speech. What spells does he have? So Sword Burst is tactical, Lightning Lore is tactical, Acid Splash is tactical, Shape Water is utility, level support, we'll class it's that. Mind Sliver is tactical, Absorb Elements, Reaction, Comprehend Languages, Support, Ice Knife is offensive, Arms of Adar is tactical, and that's tactical. Right, so I'm going to say that his only support abilities is in the form of using Fonts of Magic or Shape Water. So let's see what he's going to choose. Okay, so Fonts of Magic. No. Fonts of Magic, what lets you do? Well, Flexible Casting. Fonts of Magic Flexible Casting allows you to transform sorcery points into a spell slot, a spell slot into a sorcery point. And this is a bonus action if I'm not mistaken. So basically what I'm going to say is he has two sorcery points from being a level 2 sorcerer. So I'm going to say that he's going to take those two sorcery points and he's going to give himself another level 1 spell slot. Obviously this will change, we have some higher levels, but we only have... So he only has two spell slots, so yes, I'm going to go 0 SP, I'll remember himself that. And the good thing is that's a bonus action, so now he has to take an attack roll action. So his only attack roll actions in the form of a quarterstaff or a dagger. Yep, attack roll. Okay, so let's see what he's going to do. Okay, so he's going to attack with his quarterstaff. Okay, so he's going to attack with his quarterstaff. So let's have a look. So we can go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we go straight for that guy. 1, 2, 3, 4. Let's go for that guy and go for that guy as well. Okay, let's do a D3 to determine which way he's going. 1. Okay. So we're just going to go 5, 10, 15, 20. And he's going to attack this guy here. So we need to do a D20 plus 3, right? And he's going to attack two hands. Okay, so it's a D20 plus 3. So I want to double check before I commit to the roll. Yep, D20 plus 3. Needs to beat an AC of 13. So which he does. Very nice. And then he's going to do a 1D8. Ah, right, yeah, 1d8 plus 1, because we have a plus 1 strength modifier. Don't know why I didn't put that. Silly Deffy. Alright, so that's 1d8 plus 1, and deals 5 points of damage. Now, I've not rolled HP yet for these three. I want to do it at the beginning of the combat, but I'll remember to put a minus, -5 on the top guy. So he's going to take minus 5, so hold on, let me just, so remember, so we go, null 1, minus 5, hit point. Because standard, we've only got 22, average without any rolls, so, you know, 5 HP, just might as well. Okay, the final one is Talita. Right, so what's Talita going to do? So we need to roll a d6 to determine. 6. 2. Okay, so it's offensively. Okay, so she has a quarterstaff, a dagger. Control Flames is support. Frostbite. That's a save. Poison Spray is a save. Thunderclap is a save. And she hasn't used Thunder Wave, Comprehend Languages to sleep yet. And she hasn't used her Levitate yet either. Okay, so it's between quarterstaff or a dagger, so let's have a look. Okay, quarterstaff. Okay. Now the question is she in range? So she's in range for the top one. 5, 10, 15, 20. Yep. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. Yep. And then 5, 10, 15, 20, 25. Okay, so she's in range for all three. So let's do a D3. Targeting the bottom one this time. Sweet. So she's going to go 5, 10, 15, 20, 25. Attack with a quarterstaff, which is a... Just a d20 plus 2 this time. So d20 plus 2. 8 misses. And that is the Advantage. I'm a donkey, I forgot advantage. Yeah, I forgot advantage on Panmon. But it still hit anyway, so we'll take that. Did I do... I didn't do advantage with... did I do advantage with... Hold on, did I do advantage? Yes, I did do advantage. Did I do advantage with... No, I didn't do advantage with Panmon, did I? With Aconite, did I? I didn't. Okay, do you know what? Yeah, just to be fair, it is a surprise round, so yeah, sure. Okay, well, he still missed anyway. Okay, that's fine. Right, so we'll do the advantage with... we'll do the advantage with Talia again. Alright, so d20 plus 2. Okay, still misses anyway. Okay, there we go. Balance has been readdressed. Okay, so yeah, so... Aconite came in, tried to swing twice, missed the first guy. Panmon came in, managed to get a nice successful quarterstaff attack on the first one. Talia taking down, attacking the bottom one. And Scar decides to back off a little bit and summon an unseen servant. See, to help out with distracting enemies and maybe some other things as well. Right, and that's where we're going to leave off, and then we will start doing combat. Right, okay, so we have battle now. That's it, we're completely in battle. So, the combat tracker is this. So, Panmon started at 22. Talita is started at 21. Null 3, which is this guy, is started at 21 as well. Then followed by Alkanak. And then Null 1, which is this guy here. And then followed by Scar. And then finally, the... Null 2. Now, I've had a look at the Unseen Servant. Does not... Basically, he acts on the same turn as Scar via a bonus action. So, unless... So, yeah. So, I'm going to say that every bonus action, unless he doesn't choose an action that requires a bonus action, if he uses, like, a main action, he'll use the bonus action to command the Unseen Servant. The Unseen Servant, I'm just going to use the same stats that it says in the spell, like an AC of 10, I think, with 2 HP, can't attack. But I'm going to use the Unseen Servant as like a Find Familiar where you can use items and do the help command and other things like that, like maybe drag some of our allies to safety, stuff like that. Also as well, we've got the HP as well. We have Panmon at 8, Talita at 5, Null 3 at 17, Alkanak at 14. Now, the Null 1, you may notice in the dice roller up there, the second where it says 18, the second lot of dice rolls that I put a minus 5. That's how much HP was taken off during the surprise attack. So it should have had, let's say 16. Yeah, so that should be 21 health, like no free, but yeah, I've minused it. So it's pretty cool. Now, before we start the fight properly, I was having a bit of a think. Now, I want to give our party the best chance of surviving, right? Now, here's the thing. I'm not going to be taking any short rests or long rests unless it mentions in the module. And in this module, it does say when to take a short rest, and we will have an opportunity for a long rest later on. So, to give these guys the best chance possible, and for all future solo D&D playthroughs, if we don't have a healer, I am going to use the optional rule in the Dungeon Master's Guide called Healing Surge. Now, Healing Surge says, as an action, a character can use a healing surge and spend up to his or her hit dice. Spend up to half his or her hit dice. For each hit die spent in this way, the player rolls a die and adds the character's constitution modifier. The character regains hit points equal to the total. The player can decide to spend an additional hit die after each roll. A character who uses a healing surge cannot do so again until he or she finishes a short or long rest. Under this optional rule, a character regains all spent hit dice at the end of a long rest. With a short rest, a character regains hit die equal to his or her level divided by 4, minimum 1 dice. So, in translation to this means that if a character rolls a 6, the healing surge action will become available because it's classed as healing. And then, obviously, it'll be part of their feats and traits and stuff, and then obviously we'll roll onto that action if need be. No, I was thinking of something a little bit more different as well. I am going to make this healing surge a bonus action as well. but I'm going to do under a specific condition. I'm going to say under maybe 20% of their max HP, they can do it as a bonus action, as an emergency sort of thing. So Talita, who's currently on 5 HP, can use a healing surge if she's under, I'm going to say minimum of 3. So if she's under 3 HP, she can roll a hit die to regain something back as a bonus action. But if anyone's above 20, it uses their action. So I'm going to do that, just to give them the best state possible. Okay, right, well, let's get started with a battle then. So, first up is Padmon. So, Padmon is currently in combat. So, let's see what he's going to do. So, we're going to roll a d6 to determine his action. 5. Okay, so support or buff. Okay, Padmon can do what for support? Okay, so we have Phantom Magic, Flexible Casting, which I believe he's already used. Yes, he's already used. Okay, so that's not... So, is that the question? Could go Shape Water. That's about it, actually. It's just... Shape Water, actually. Yeah. Okay, right. Well, here's what we're gonna do. So, because his only actions, his only actions is Healing Surge and Shape Water. So let's do a D2. 1 for Healing Surge, 2 for Shape Water. Okay, so he's going to do the Shape Water cantrip. So, Shape Water is a very utility type spell, and I'll explain how it works in a second. So, Shape Water says, you choose an area of water that you can see within range that fits within the 5 feet cube. You manipulate it in one of the following ways. You instantly move or I change the flow of the water as you direct it to 5 feet in any direction. This movement does not have enough force to cause damage. You cause the water to form into simple shapes and animate your direction. The cast lasts for 1 hour. You change the colors, the water's color or opacity. The water must be changed the same way throughout. The change lasts for 1 hour. And you can freeze the water provided there is no creatures in it. The water freezes in 1 hour. No. Also, you can cast a spell multiple times, but you can have no more than 2 of its non-instantaneous effects active at a time. You can dismiss such effect as an action. So, what I'm going to say is this. So right now, Padmon realizes that he's in combat, he's in melee combat, but he notices that there is a little bit of a blood patch underneath the knoll. So, now blood is made up of X amount of water, so what he's going to do is kind of simple. He's going to cast Shape Water, and he's going to freeze the blood underneath the knoll. So by doing this, it's going to cause a slippery surface, so the knoll must make a dexterity saving throw, otherwise he will be bone prone. So I think that's what we're going to do. So for that, he's going to make a dexterity saving throw, so it's 12 plus 1, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to put it towards Panmon's spell DC. So let's do that then. So we're going to do a d20 plus 1. And under 14. Nope. It's fine. So Padmon raises his hand out. You see some kind of a glyph that happens on his hand. And then the blood underneath the knoll starts to freeze up, causing a slippery surface. But the knoll, noticing what's happening, slips and slides a little bit, but manages to keep his balance. And that's the end of Padmon's turn. Actually, speaking of which, do you know what I forgot to do? Forgot to do a turn thing here. So let's put one up here. Turn round one. Okay, so next is Talita. So Talita is currently engaged with Knoll 3. So let's see what she's going to do. 5. Okay, so Talita has an option of Healing Surge. There we go. She's got 2 sorcery points. Flexible Casting. Draw Flames is utility, is support, Crossbite isn't, Sleep isn't. Okay, so she's got a choice between, Levitate as well, that's support as well. Okay, so she's got a choice between, okay, I'm going to say that she has a choice between Healing or Levitate. So what's she going to do? Okay, so she's going to use Healing Surge. So, because this is above the 20% threshold, it's going to take her action. Now she can only use up to half a hit die. So as you can see, we only have 2d6s for a hit die, so she can only roll a 1d6. But it does add her constitution modifier to the roll. So it's going to be d6 plus 2. She regains 4 HP back. Okay, and then what I'm going to do is I'm going to do this if it's possible. So remember. Let me go. 1. Hit die. Okay. Perfect. 1 hit die. And she's going to gain 4 HP back. Okay, so that's got 9 HP back. And then she's going to end her turn. Okay, Knoll 3, which is this guy. So currently engaged with Talita, so that's going to be his target. So here's the thing. So as per the module, it says that does not use shields, does not use any weapons, but instead makes a bite attack. So it's a d20 plus 4. So that's what we're going to do. So we're going to do d20 plus 4. 10 just misses as the Knoll just starts to tries to bite forward, tries to lunge at Talita's shoulder, but instead only meets the back end of her cape instead as she dodges out of the way. No multi-attacks, right? Nope, just one attack. Okay, so that's it for Knoll 3. Okay, Akinak. What's Akinak gonna do? Let's have a look. Oh, also as well, the dodge action. Forgot about the dodge action. The dodge action is going to be support and buff as well. You know, I need to go over all the actions, actually. That's a good question. Because there's a lot of optional actions I could take. So the dodge action, just to, while I'm on track. When you take the dodge action, all attack rolls against the person that dodge is with disadvantage. Nope, because, okay, one, so he's going to attack, so nope, he's not going to dodge, that's what I was going to say. Nope, he's going to do a roll instead. Right, so we're talking longsword and dagger. Yep, longsword and dagger, so let's see what he's attacking with. Okay, so he's attacking with the dagger. Alright, and how many daggers he got? Just the one, right? Okay, so he's just going to make one attack. Okay, so he's going to attack the Knoll 1. So there's going to be an AC of 13. So we want d20 plus 4, right? D20 plus 4, 7 misses. Alright, so he tries to stab with the dagger, ends up missing, and that's his turn. Okay, so next is Knoll 1, which is this guy. Now, Knoll 1 is currently engaged with Akinak and Panmon, so we need to decide who he's targeting. So let's go for 2. So 1 is Akinak, 2 is Panmon. Okay, so we're sacking Akinak. Now, that is a D20 plus 4, right? Yeah, D20 plus 4. Alright. So d20 plus 4, 23 hits. Ouch. Yeah, as he gets his jaws in and starts cracking at the carapace of Akinak, potentially injuring a bit of his under soft meat. His soft meat in the inside, should we say. Okay, so what's the damage? It's 1d4 plus 2, so let's have a look. So d4 plus 2. Deals 4 points of piercing damage. Ouch. And that brings him down to 10 HP. Okay, so Akinak's got 10 HP left. So next is Scar. Right, let's see what Scar's going to do. Is he actually going to help? Or is he just going to keep running away and shit? 2. Okay, so he's actually going offensive. Okay, so Scar's option for his offensive is Dagger, Darts, Chill Touch. He doesn't have any more spell slots, he doesn't. So it's just a, okay. So it's a toss up between Dagger, Darts, or Chill Touch. Now, is he within 30 feet range? So 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30 is for the bottom one. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. So he is it for the second one, but he can throw the dagger if he chooses dagger. Or we can go 5, 10, 15, 20. Okay. Right, so I want to double check. So he's in within 30 feet range of the top and bottom one, but he's up this one. So let's see what he attacks with. So we do a D3. Okay, so he's going to attack with Chill Touch. Now the range and tilt Chill Touch. So the range and tilt Chill Touch is 120 feet. And it's a ranged spell attack. So on a hit, target takes 1d8 necrotic damage and you cannot regain hit points at the start of the next turn. Okay, no problem. Sounds good to me. Right, so we need to decide. So he doesn't really need to move into range, so he's got 1, 2, and 3. So who's he targeting? Okay, so he's targeting Gnoll 2, this guy here. Right, so we need to do a d20 plus 3, and needs to beat the AC. 6 misses. Fires the Spectral Astral Hand towards Gnoll 2, but fortunately, sends up overreaching. Okay, so now we need to decide where he's moving and how close or how far. So then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Hold on, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Let's do a d7. 6. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So he's moving in this direction. So how many squares? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 squares, is that right? 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. Okay, 6. Alright, let's do a d6. 4 squares. Okay, so he's moving 4 squares northeast. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. And then he's going to do a bonus action. And I'm going to take control of this. So obviously, I'm going to say he's got 30 feet. So he's going to go 5, 10, 15, 20. And I'm going to say he's just going to stand by Panmon ready. Ready to do what precisely? I have no idea. We shall see. Okay, so after Scar's turn, it's now Gnoll 2. Okay, so he's not engaged with anyone. So the question is, who is he going to target? So we're going to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All right. His target is D5, which is Talita. So Talita, so he's just going to move forward one. He's going to attack a bone. He's going to do a light attack. Okay, so it's a D20 plus 4. 16 hits. 1d4 plus 2. 6 points of damage. Ooh, 6 points of damage as the gnoll just comes up to near enough behind her and just starts biting and ripping her arm off. Jesus. Dealing 6 points of damage. So that leaves her with 8. That leaves her with 3 HP again. That was a waste of the healing surge, wasn't it? Yeah, I'm not gonna lie, I have a feeling that we're gonna lose one or two characters over the next couple of next couple of counters, I'll tell you that much right now. Yeah, 3 HP. And with that is the end of round one, and now we're on round two.